Ladies and gentlemen, just before we start another episode of the Fitness Academy podcast, just a reminder for those who are listening on YouTube that we are now on Spotify. So please head down into the link in the description and check us out there. On with the episode.
Try and enjoy what you're doing because it's gone sometimes. And, you know, I don't mean that in a really depressing way. I just mean the fact that, you know, you might be playing cricket one day, but you might not be in a few years' time. Just make the most of it. The thing that I kind of try my hardest to live by is find a way. I'm always trying to find a way. I'm not good at many things. I have zero skill, but the things that I do is I try as hard as I can, and I'm trying to find a way. Always trying to find a way. So I'd say find your way, and jump onto people around you and close. Don't be afraid to ask for ideas and advice.
Welcome back, everyone, to another episode of the Fitz Academy podcast. This is a special one for me to film because Simon Guy, obviously, as many of you know, or if you haven't known, you need to open your eyes. Former professional cricketer for Yorkshire for 11 years, it was. And now, obviously, onto his coaching role. Obviously, worked with the likes of the ECB, the Lightning, Durham, a hell of a lot. And we'll get into it in a lot because I'll spend 50 minutes introducing him. Si, thanks so much for coming
on, mate.
No worries. So, Si, obviously, I don't know if you watched any episodes. I start off nice and childish and then get off on a tangent and we go nice and serious mode. And this is an interesting question because in Paul Legler, who was also another former coach of mine, we spoke about one piece of kit that a coach has in their arsenal. Now, as a cricket coach and as an absolute badger of cricket myself, there's a hell of a lot of tools that we can use. If you could only select one within all three disciplines, obviously, you guys should know, obviously, Simon's was a wicketkeeper and obviously a wicketkeeping specialist, so he's obviously has to take that into consideration as well. Oh, not playing kit, so obviously not pads, not bat, anything like that, coaching kit.
Hard one. If I was only allowed one, I think probably the one that I think is most fun and most valuable to me would be my foam stumps, because every time the ball hits and it goes through, so the keeper always gets a catch. They get deflection. You might be able to use them for nicking. We use them for fielding as well. So that probably been one of my most helpful tools, I reckon.
Oh, that's good. He's thought about it as well. He's thought about it. That's good. I hate it when people just give me one word answer and it's done. He's thought about it. He's thought about which discipline he uses it, and he cracked on. So like I mentioned, guys, onto the serious stuff now. To a certain extent, we've spoken a little bit and we're giving you an extremely broad introduction, but. Like I mentioned in the last episode, I like to take that of someone who has never met you before. So can you tell myself and the viewers like sort of a little bit about your journey, mate, from playing on to coaching?
Yes, but I grew up in a family that played cricket. I wonder if any of your listeners have kind of watched the Flintoff documentary, which has been interesting. It talks about, you know, people that are, you know, more like to be involved in cricket tend to be either from an affluent environment or from an area where, you know, their family plays cricket. So that's kind of how I got into it. Ironically, both my brothers were world beaters and I wasn't. So my job was literally just to fetch balls back. So that's kind of how it happened for me. There's an age gap between them and they were both brilliant. And I was the fastest by a long shot. So literally my job was to fetch balls back. And I mean, they were world beaters at five. So I kind of didn't really get into cricket until I was about 10. And, I got into it at competitive school because no other sports play in the summer, so we got into it there. And it wasn't until I was 13 that I started keeping wicket. I used to bowl some mean medium pace, probably about 4 or 5 mile an hour. It was rubbish. But that's kind of how I kind of got into it. And the reason I kept wicket was because my dad said, don't keep wicket one day. Now, my dad was an awesome keeper. I mean, ridiculous. Miles better than me. But he
played second 11, didn't he? Yeah. Like, so
he got offered a contract by Worcester, but unfortunately turned it down. Ridiculously, because at that time he was doing his electrical apprenticeship. So, he was really good, but his hands were mangled, his knees were a mess. So he said, obviously, don't do it. So like all good children, you do the exact opposite to what your parents say. And then I got into it through that. Absolutely loved it. You know, it was just immediately I was just hooked. You know, you're involved in every ball. You know, you're, as you can probably see, although I'm sat down right now, I'm only about 2'3", so I'm I'm a noisy little midget, so, you know, it's perfect for keepers. So it was just hooked immediately. And then after a couple of years, I was lucky enough to play for Yorkshire under-15s, which was, you know, my brothers were trying to get into that for years, and unfortunately they didn't get into it. They did when they were a bit older. They got into some representatives of themselves. But I got in just out of the blue, really. And ironically, at the same time, I played Yorkshire rugby and Yorkshire cricket in the same year. And same for both of them. I kind of never really expected to do any of those. And it just kind of, it just happened. And I really enjoyed it. And it just, the passion and the love just grew from there. I think sometimes falling into things by accident is a lot better than, you know, I worry about some kids that are driven from a young age and unfortunately lose the love for the game, which is understandable. But I literally just tripped over it and found a path and got really lucky, which I think sometimes you've got to be. There's other times in my career I wasn't lucky, but at this instance I was. And they used to do what's called a YTS, which is an OPEC scheme, it's called. So it's like an apprenticeship. And I joined Yorkshire on that apprenticeship at 16. So I finished with GCSEs. And went there, and it was amazing. It was the best thing I ever did. It was a great introduction. Other people that were on it were people like Ryan Sybottom, who played for Yorkshire, Notts in England. Chris Silverwood played for England, head England coach, head Sri Lankan coach. You know, there were lots of people that went through that transition, because it was a great thing. You used to feed bowling machines all day for the first class cricketers. You go out and coach in schools. Schools would come to you. You get to train every day. You're working with people like Ralph Middlebrook and Arnie Sybottom, who's Ryan's dad, who also played football for Man United and cricket for Yorkshire and England. So you were just around amazing people, and it was just unreal. And you got to live in Leeds, in Headingley as well. And at 16 years old, that was just unreal. You know, you were in, you had a landlady who looked after you, but you could go and have a couple of cheeky beers as well, because you didn't need a driver's license or anything in that era. So, you know, you're around all the students, and just the atmosphere, the environment was just amazing. You were next to the rugby league at Leeds Rhinos. It was just a hotbed for sport and people, and it was just phenomenal. So that was my first real transition. And I don't think, it wasn't really until the back end of that when I was 18 that I thought, you know what, I might actually play proper cricket here. I might have a chance. But while I was there between 16 and 18, I played for Yorkshire Academy. I played a couple of second team games as well. I ironically got my first 50 and my first 100 in the same season for Yorkshire 2s at 18. I ended up averaging 100 that year, which just shows you that stats can be false stats. So it just happened that I got 50 not out, 100 not out, and I played a couple of other games as well. So I ended up at the end of the season with an average of just over 100. So sounds great.
Not too bad.
It was a bit of a false stat, really. But it was nice to get my first 50, my first 100. And then from that, I picked up a junior pro. And then it went from there. So I was actually Yorkshire as a whole for 16 years, around amazing people, amazing coaches, and unbelievable environment. And then 11 of those years ended up being part of the first class staff, which, same again, I was lucky to be around it and loved every minute of it. I mean, you know, lots of people walk out of the professional game disappointed and you know, I don't know, I'm trying to think how to word it best, but, you know, a bit disappointed with the environment, the finishing the sport, feel a bit hard done by. I always felt I was very, very honoured and very lucky to play for Yorkshire, you know, so although I would like to, there are other things I would like to have done more and done better, without a shadow of a doubt, we all would. But I can't complain at the opportunity that I had and the people that are around. Loved every minute of it. So that's kind of how it happened for me.
How did sort of then you feel signing professional after, obviously, you've grown up in such a big cricketing family? Because often you, more often than not, all the sort of professionals I've spoken to, they've actually, believe it or not, never had anyone who's played sort of cricket in their family, or they've been a massive sort of rugby background and no cricket whatsoever. Was it always cricket for you from a young age? Or like you said, you obviously grew up rugby as well.
Yeah, well, ironically, it's the same with the wicket keeping. I fell into rugby. I got to comprehensive school and at 11, everyone played football. And, you know, my dad, bless him, always said that, oh, well, you're not very good at football. No one gave me a chance. You know, they were too busy with the two brothers. Now, I think this is probably something for young people to hook onto here, that sometimes being the outlier and being separate from it all is a massive advantage. Like, my brothers were throwing balls all day and things like that, and I just rocked up and caught a few balls. It was great. Loved every minute of it. And rugby was the same. So first year at comprehensive school, I played a little bit of football. I probably wasn't very good, but no one would kick the ball at me, but I was flipping rapid. I covered every blade of grass, but never touched the ball. So I was good for that. But then in the second form, people said, oh, have you ever tried rugby? And we were doing it in PE, and I thought, oh, you know, it's a good bit of fun, this. And being a 2'3" midget that can run around like a lunatic, it kind of suited me, you know. Get him on the wing. That's it, lots of energy to expand. I gave it a go, and I started playing that. I wasn't great, but I was understanding how the game worked. I had good hand-eye coordination, lots of energy. So I started playing on the flank. I played in the backs. And ironically, by the age of 13, our hooker was just getting a bit taller now, so he was going to play in the flanker in the second row. And ironically, that same hooker now is actually with my sister. So it's amazing how things work around now. So that they're in a very loving relationship. But he moved out nicely into the flanker of the second row. I ended up playing hooker. So I as you can tell, I'm an okay size, but I'm not huge.
Yeah.
I couldn't do it nowadays. The size have changed. But in that era, I played hooker, and I ended up playing hooker for Yorkshire, which is fantastic.
Wow.
I was a great striker with the ball, a good line-out throw, and I ran around like a flanker and covered loads of grass and didn't mind sticking my head in the inappropriate places and getting knocked over. So like I say, rugby was very similar in that respect. I fell into it, but loved every minute of it, and it was brilliant. You know, I think sometimes being involved in by being a big family with two brothers and a sister, but being in a completely different sport that they weren't attached to or involved in was amazing. It was just my time. And my mum never watched a game until I played for Yorkshire. So I've been playing 3 years. She never saw one game. Turned up to watch a Yorkshire game and thought, this is a bit rough, isn't it? And it was just, sometimes things just happen and you've got to get out and try things and embrace it. And I think I tried a few things there and immediately got hooked to both of them.
Looking back on that now, have you ever spoken to both your brothers? I've had the honour of meeting Stu. Have you ever sort of looked back and been like, right, I reckon I sort of potentially sort of made it a little bit further, if you like, because I enjoyed it and it wasn't much of like a sort of a be all end all, I need to play professional cricket, versus actually enjoyed every minute of it and it just naturally happened?
Yeah, we've had a couple of little random chats about it, but I think we're all on our own path. We don't know where it's going and what it's going to do. So for someone to say I did better than them, did worse than them, I do think it comes more down to probably my own personal learning styles. You know, me being out there, we were lucky in our era that we could play 7 days a week. I got to play a game pretty much every day. And the amount of learning I got from that, so my level of coach support I got was zero, but the amount of games I played was through the roof. So my potential there to make mistakes and learn and try again tomorrow was just priceless. If I had got that, I don't think I would have learned as quick. And that goes through my whole life now. I'm very good at that. I learn quick. I make mistakes and move on from those things. And I think that accidental environment was probably really healthy for me, but it probably knocks on at time to my coaching as well. So just doing a thing called Spotlight at the moment, which I'm going through, which is just looking at my preferences and things like that, which is I find interesting. And you can, when you see and hear bits, you reflect back on parts of your life, and it's good to have those opportunities because you can share them with other people as well, you know, in that respect that we do. We get highly coached now, but we're also looking for self-thinking cricketers or self-thinking sportsmen and women as well. So you just have to be careful of where we go, because if we overcoach, we don't allow that opportunity to learn. But then if we leave everybody to it, we don't allow them the support they need as well. So it's high challenge, high support, but it's just trying to make it all fit together.
And it's funny that you mentioned that, because I was going to mention it a bit later on, but I'm going to jump on it now because, you know, I can dictate where it goes. You did a sort of Q&A with Cork Cricket Club, like sort of just coming out of lockdown, I think it was a few years ago. And one thing that stuck to me was you brought out this book and it was speaking about sort of finding your weaknesses and finding your strengths and how to work on them. And it's funny that you mentioned that, an environment very, very similar to what you just said, where you kind of have to sort of teach them how to be a good person and how to deal with things as a person as well as a cricketer, because they're human at the end of the day, isn't it?
Yeah, and that's part of the Spotlight thing. It's about me working out about me, my preferences, what worked well for me, what doesn't work well for me, but then also finding out other people's and then seeing how does mine match, or how might mine challenge theirs, or how might we create conflict here but be okay with it, or actually be careful of it. And, you know, there's no better thing than working yourself out. It's an amazing thing. When I first did my level 4, which I finished in, I think it was about 2009 now.
Yeah, last year, wasn't it? I saw as well, you said you admitted to yourself that you absolutely barred me for still playing professional cricket and then finishing your level 4.
We did Myers-Briggs, so it's just MBTI, which I really like. And there's things from the Spotlight that I'm picking up which are very similar to that, but I liked that. And it was a really interesting thing that helped me at that age learn about me. Now, I felt that I wish I'd have got that information earlier, but I also think that I don't think I'd have been able to process it the way I could when I was older. And there's a lot to be said for that. I think some parts of my Spotlight that I've looked at today, I think are influenced by my age and maturity. And I know you see me, I'm a bit daft at times, but I have matured in some ways. But I think that if I look back at it 10 years ago, I might have seen the world and things very differently. And I think that that's a, part we have to embrace and accept that, you know, we need a bit of time to mature and develop. And I listened to a great podcast the other day with Peter Moore's name. It's brilliant. He talked about, you know, I mean, he's an amazing coach. His knowledge is phenomenal and a wonderful person. And he talked about, you know, it's okay to say that I don't know everything. You know, if he's saying it's okay, it must be okay. And I brought that comment up the other day when I was delivering a session for staff's cricket, because these are young and some old coaches. But, you know, people say, look, it's okay to not have all the answers. The difference is if you put your hand and say, right, but you know what, I'm going to go and find some answers for you. Now, that's a different conversation. You know, I think the getting to know yourself is a phenomenal thing. You know, understanding what might trip you up, what might not trip you up. Or actually, when I'm in this stressful position, why do I make those decisions, or why do I feel that way? You know, and it's not to say that you always need to have the answers for that, but you know, a greater understanding of you, you know, is a wonderful thing. It really is. Like I say, but I don't think I'd have been able to process that kind of information when I was younger.
It goes. It kind of relates to what I speak about a lot, which is experience over sort of knowledge in a certain way, where you kind of have to make mistakes a little bit in order to not be successful, but sort of then move forward and never make those mistakes again, because it's far easier to kind of learn from it than just sort of say, all right, he's told me that this is not the right way, so I'm not going to do it like this.
Yeah, and it takes about a little bit of high challenge, high support. So, I mean, with the Lightning, for instance, we'll set up tasks that are difficult and that are awkward and that are uncomfortable, because we want to trip people up. We want to support them then. So after they've tripped up and fallen over, we can sort them and say, all right, well, what was difficult? Or why did we find that hard? If we did it again, what would you do differently? And then give them a chance to do it again and try it and learn and then make a different decision or have another option. Because we might need 5 or 6 goals at it, because we might make different options that don't work. So, you know, that's a great part, having that opportunity to explore those things as well. But I think, you know, it's allowing those opportunities to do it, but obviously being supported as well. There are times where we try and step back and not support them, because you can't ask them to be self-thinking cricketers if you don't let them think for themselves. So it's a balance of having all those opportunities to make those things happen for people and explore.
Cool. So moving on to your time sort of in the professional game, which obviously I think what a lot of people want to talk about, you've played sort of 37 first-class games, 32 List A and 10 T20. That's a lot of games, obviously, across the course of 11 years, where sort of, I said, you're part of the professional staff and you were able to sort of play for what you had been working for that time. Did you almost feel quite surreal when you actually had made it? Or was it like, no, look, you know, I've worked hard to be here. You know, I maybe not deserve to be here, but sort of I've earned the right to be here. That's probably the better way of saying it.
I never felt like I really made it. I think if you look at that, I would class that as that's just an okay run. You know, I would like to have played a lot more. Many people played considerably more games than I did. And I think, you know, I had a few little bits of a bit of bad luck at times, you know, right place, right time. You're only one keeper. So there's lots of difficulties. There's people who played before me. Richard Blake was an excellent keeper and a batter, and he never got injured in flipping 400 years. So, you know, the opportunities that come for you, you have to be patient and wait. And then when they do come, then, you know, at certain times probably wasn't managed as well as it could have been managed and things like that. And it's, you know, they're all helpful experiences now as a coach. They're brilliant. So if I hadn't gone through that, I wouldn't have those tools in my toolbox. At the time, it was heartbreaking, but now I use them as great, brilliant tools to be able to relate to people or make sure that I don't make those mistakes. So I never felt I made it. I think an interesting thing was that I probably felt at the back end of my career, I probably genuinely felt I belonged. Earlier on in my career, I was trying to find my own way, my own path, and trying to understand about myself, my game. My batting improved as I got a bit older, because I didn't really get much coaching until that stage. And a guy called Kevin Sharp, you might have seen him on things with Joe Root and things like that. He was probably our first main batting coach at Yorkshire. It was brilliant. And he was really the first instance I got any actual support in that. So as I got older, I got better and probably got more confident with it. But that was just coming towards the back end of my transition, which is a bit of a shame. But from a keeping point of view, we didn't really get much keeping support. It was all you did your own drills, you looked after your own game and you developed yourself. You know, and I was an excitable creature, so that was all right for me, but we probably didn't get as much support as we do now. And it wasn't until the back end of my career that I actually thought, you know what, I'm flipping good at this. I'm a good keeper. But up till then, as a young keeper, I was always trying to think, well, am I? Or what else do I need to be doing? Or can I be better? Or what am I missing? What else should I be doing? Or all that, you know, creating that doubt of, oh, if I miss a chance, I'm going to drop next week. You know, and you can't live life like that. you know, but you look at all the psychological support we have now and all the information we get and the coaching support, God, it would have made a big difference in my life, like it would have many other people. You know, living your life from day to day, worrying about, oh, am I playing next week, is a nightmare. And I went through that position from a couple of years, and you got to think, how can you perform at your best at a high level when you're constantly worrying about what's coming? Whereas that opportunity to say, look, just go, enjoy yourself, embrace what you do. We trust you. We back you. We'll support you. You're going to play. Go have some fun. That's a very different conversation than saying, geez, if I drop a catch, I'm going to drop next week.
Yeah.
The mindset thing, and it's phenomenal. And even people now, with all the support we have, we still have players that go through that. And it's a horrible thing. It's probably a passage through sport itself to say, I've been there. I know how it feels. I can understand it. I can share it, but I can learn from it and get better. But we used to be a little bit on our own with that, and there wasn't really, you know, much light at the end of the tunnel. So that's probably something that I came across that I haven't really talked much about, because I haven't really been asked much about it. But I can definitely relate to players that are going through that transition of game to game, and that's not easy. It's part of the game, though. We have to accept it. Yeah. You know, being at the top end, you know, you're always fighting for your spot. You know, unfortunately, as a keeper, there's only one spot, which is a bit tricky.
It's funny that you mention, again, that, like, there was so much transition going on, and again, in that interview, you kind of mentioned how there was the transition period where sort of gone were the days where you used to sort of go down the pub for about 10 and then sort of go next day and play the next day of play. It must have been quite difficult for you to try and sort of balance all of these changes all at once whilst, again, still learning as a young player, no?
Yeah, well, I mean, I was lucky because, you know, I could have a couple of pints. I still ran around like a monster the next day. I had it built into me because I had a good engine. But the trouble is, we went through periods because it did it. It had that, you know, you're away on your own. I mean, it's not like football. Football, they might travel the day before, they play the game, they come home. Cricket, you go the day before, you're there for 4 days and then you're back. Or you might be on a 2-week trip. So you might be down south, might be playing Hampshire, then across to Sussex, you know, and you might be away for 2 weeks. So it's difficult not being in your own bed. You know, there's not much else to do in the night time. They go and have a beer and a bite to eat. And it's a worry for the kids now because they're opposite, because they're in bed by 8:30. They're having a protein shake and going to sleep and thinking, you're forgetting there's a life to be lived as well. So
yeah,
it's having the balance. So it's finding the right time to go out nowadays anyway. It's find the right time when an opportunity comes to go out, blow some steam off, have a drink and be a normal human being. You've got to embrace it. But obviously then when you've got to do the business the next day, you've also got to be prepared for that as well. So in our era, it was just a little bit, yeah, you probably had a few more, but you had to say, you've got to go and get on with it. And we've all made those mistakes, and people still do it now, and people still get it wrong. So there's no perfect science to that, apart from trip up, get it wrong, but don't do it again.
It's all about sort of balance, isn't it? Whether you're a professional cricketer, average Joe, sort of working 9 to 5, working balance and sort of enjoying balance, or work hard, play hard, balance, whatever you want to call it. It's kind of what makes us human beings at the end of the day, because if someone's either working 24/7 or training 24/7 or either in the pub 24/7, it's going to have an imbalance, and it's going to need to affect other things at the end of the day, isn't it?
Yeah, it's just life, full stop. Get a balance, but you've got to flip and enjoy yourself. I mean,
yeah,
I think I definitely enjoyed myself. It's probably too much sometimes, but I don't think you can. I don't think you can run away from that, because you could look back and say, oh, I wish I'd have done this. And there are many things, don't we? I don't regret anything, but there are things I wish I'd done a bit more of that. You know, but when it comes to enjoying myself and having fun, I probably did the fair quota.
That's awesome. So, and this is one that I was sort of very sort of 50-50, because in February 2009, where you mentioned that it came sort of, there's some good bits which came in your favour and some didn't. Can you talk to us a bit more about that? Because obviously I've heard it from yourself, thankfully. You know, I've obviously worked with you for a fair bit. But what exactly happened? So for our viewers, so they know exactly sort of how that sort of came to an end with the career.
Yeah, well, it was an entertaining year, I'll give you that. So at the start of the year, I started having headaches, and like really bad headaches. It was like being punched in the head every 2 seconds. It was horrible. So I went to the doctor. So I'm having really bad headaches. I'm feeling a bit dizzy and things like that. And they gave me some, I think it was just some ibuprofen, and said, oh, you know what, well, doesn't seem to be anything there. So then I went home. A couple of days later, I'm kind of same again, in a lot of pain now, really struggling, and went back again. We even called out a doctor at one point, and I started to, like, my brain was working. People had known my whole life. I couldn't tell you the name. I knew it in my head, but I couldn't get it out. You know, when you forget something, you can't get that name. It was like that every minute. I had to crawl downstairs to the kitchen, to the toaster, to try and explain to my then wife about, because I couldn't eat it, I was being sick all the time, that I wanted to try crumpets. I couldn't say what they were. I crawled down the stairs. So I said, you put them in a toaster. What? And they'd say, what, bread? No, toast? No, no. And I'm getting frustrated because I knew what I wanted to do. I just couldn't get it out. And yeah. I had no idea what was going on. I just thought, I don't know. I was just probably not with it. So that went on for about 7, 8, 9 days. And I had a day where I woke up. I thought, oh, I feel all right now. And we had a level 4 course on that week. So stuff it. I'll go. I got down there, went to the gym and wasn't picking anything heavy, but I realized I was completely off balance. I couldn't pick something up and I felt like I was going to fall over. So I went to my room, got some tea, went to bed, and then kind of woke up the next day and walked through the breakfast area. I kept walking into tables. I couldn't literally stand up. I was like all over the place. I'm just going to nip to my room. And I made it to my room and passed out on the floor and the cleaner had found me. And I'd kind of like come around and then, oh, this gets even better, this. And then I thought, I've got to go. I've got to get home. So Loughborough to Darlington is probably about a 3-hour drive.
Yeah.
So I drove home.
Oh my word.
In the snow. And I got home and passed out in the bed. And I woke up like later on. And I wasn't sure how I got. And I remember setting off. I remember getting there. But I cannot tell you how I did it. I think just muscle memory must have just got me home. So anyway, this had gone on for about 2 weeks. And then the club doctor at Yorkshire, bless him, who genuinely saved my life, said, come down and see us. So mum and dad came up, picked me up, drove me down, stopped halfway, threw up, got back in the car, carried on. And then I got there and within less than an hour, he said, you're off to A&E, I've rung them, you're on your way. So, well, what do you mean? He said, well, just get yourself there, they'll sort you out. I'd actually got a delivery. I was sponsored by Grey Nichols then, and I got a delivery. And one of the lads had got his bag put in with it as well. So I got my mum and dad, before going to A&E for emergency surgery, to drive to Headingley, drop the bag off with me in the car. And then we carried on down to A&E. And then in no time, I was signing in disclaimers for brain surgery. And they pumped me full of morphine. I'd been in agony for 2 weeks. I was absolutely off the radar. I was so high, it was unbelievable. I'm like telling jokes to the nurses like, you know, I'd had 10 pints. It was just amazing. I think it was just the shock of not being in pain. But I had no idea what was going on. I'm just making a joke of everything. I was absolutely off the wall. And then literally I woke up and I was in a room and I just had brain surgery. So they drilled a hole in through my head. They got out what they could. And then I had to stay in hospital for 2 months. So they put a line in through my arm into my heart and every 4 hours pumped me full of chemicals for 2 months straight.
Oh.
And it was one of those things where you look back and you think, God, what the... In all fairness, I don't reflect back on it very often. It's just when people talk and it's nice to do that. But I look back and I wasn't allowed to go private because they said, look, there's every chance this could go wrong. You'll have to come back in here for emergency surgery, so we can't really let you out. So I'm literally sat on a ward getting pumped from the chemicals every 4 hours with about 8 other people. And some of the people were like, they were in one day and they were gone the next. And when I say gone, they hadn't gone home. And you're thinking, Jesus Christ, it's just, you know, humbling beyond belief. And I always felt personally, obviously being young and stupid as well, that you know, people who commit suicide, it's a weak get out of that. That's what weak people do. But I looked around that room and I thought to myself, you can see, I can fully understand. I have huge compassion for people that are at that level of pain, not knowing where they're going, you know, people with brain tumors, brain abscesses, just all, and you're thinking, Jesus, I can totally understand, you know, where they're going and really sympathize and feel for them. So, and then they said to me that you won't play this season and you probably won't ever play again. So the lads were going on tour to Dubai, Abu Dhabi, and flipping heck, missed out on a great trip there. But my one of them came and picked me up and I went to see him off on the bus and said goodbye and all that. And then came back to my little room in my ward in the hospital. And then it got to when they came back and I'd been home for a few weeks and thought, well, I'm not sure where this is going to go because they take your driver's license off you as well for 12 months after you've had brain surgery.
Oh, wow.
And I lived about an hour and 15 away. So the only way I could get to work was to pedal a bike to a train station, train station from Darlington to Leeds, Leeds to Headingley on the bike with a cricket bag on my back. That was the only way I could get to work. So I thought, stuff it, I'm going to give it a go. Rang up the coach, Kevin Sharp, like, can I come in at a few balls, can I do a few drills? So we did a few drills and I said, look, you know, I reckon I can do it. I reckon I can play. I ended up playing the whole season. The funny parts are, the first like practice match I played in, all the lads didn't want to bowl at me because they didn't want to hit me on the head. Saying, yes, and you've got to help me out. You've got to bowl properly. You've got to try and bowl properly. And they were a bit reluctant at first, but I ended up getting about 40 or 50 in a practice match. I watched it, it was great fun. I felt pretty good. But I said, look, you've got to bowl. You've got to bounce me. You've got to do something. You've got to make it real. Otherwise, I don't know. I had to keep wicket in a scrummaging helmet as well, just in case the ball hit me on the head. I looked like a right pillock. Honestly, it was horrendous. Because I had the hole drilled through the air, through the soft tissue. So they were unsure that if something hit me on the head, whether they damaged the skull or what they drilled through.
Yeah.
So I looked like a right wally. But I kept wicket in it, got on with it. And in all fairness, things felt normal. You know, sorry to randomly go off track, but a funny story. So as a cricketer, I was a pretty good athlete. And after I had a brain surgery about 2 weeks after being sat in the hospital, I thought, you know what, I've got to get myself ready. I've got to get going again. So I got my mum and dad to buy me a stepper so I could do some steps in my room. But I'd not walked for like 3 or 4 weeks. I'd done nothing. My whole body had deteriorated. My legs were just shocking. So I thought, right, I'm on the stepper. And then week after that, I thought, yeah, I can do this. So I started doing shuttles on the stairs.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, I know. And the doctor walked past me one day and reported me to the nurses. And then the doctors came in to see me and said, you can't do that. I said, yeah, but I feel all right. And at the time, I was fuming because if I'd have found out who that doctor was, I'd have knocked him back down the stairs myself because I'm thinking, look, I'm trying to recover. I'm trying to do the right thing. I'm trying to get my body going again. I'm trying to do, you want people to recover. I'm trying to do the right thing. Obviously, they know more than I do, so I do apologise. But at that time, I was frustrated because I was trying to get back to the norm, what I do all the time. And it was difficult. But yeah, you just reminded me of that then. But I think if I'd have bumped into that doctor, it might not have gone very well at that time. Quite frustrated. And then, yeah, I played all year and I played a couple of first-class games, which is amazing, you know, to walk on the pitch. Ironically, in a couple of games, I actually played. So the keeper then, Gerard Brophy, was injured in a couple of games. So they brought me in to keep in the last part of the game. So unfortunately, it's changed now. So they don't go down as my catchers. So I got about four catches against Durham.
Oh, no.
I won the game at the back end of it. Another game I played in as well. Gerard Brophy was a better batter than me, but I think I was just a bit better keeper than him. We were a good transition together. But I nipped into those games as well, so it was just nice to be involved with them. And it was just, I played every game that year, like, you know, it was just fun. It was just enjoyable. You know, I had a Guinness after the game, lads were having ice baths, I got in the bubble bath. You know, I thought, I'm enjoying the ride here. So that was kind of how that happened. And then at the back end of it, it come to probably the end of my opportunity. Johnny Bairstow was coming through, and as you know, he's a flipping phenomenal player, so he was the right person to move in. So my contract was then finished and it wasn't renewed, so I kind of lost my job that I'd been there for 16 years. I was coming to the back end of my level four, so I had my level four exam as well, which anybody that's done that will tell you, it is an absolute half a day of just rigmarole, just questions and brainstorming. Wow, it's just brain-blowing. So I managed to get myself through that. I then also managed that winter to go on tour as an assistant coach, a wicket-keeping coach in the 19s. And you had the likes of Joe Root on there, Ben Stokes, Butler, Vince.
They're all right. It's not bad.
Decent cricketers. That, you
know, they can play.
Decent year, but it was a challenging, difficult year. And to be fair, I can't complain because the doctor said if I'd left it 24 hours, I'd have been coming down to see him in a wooden box. So, you know, when people tell you things like that, you can't really complain about the world, can you? You know, I do genuinely feel that all the time, extra time that I have had is extra time. I don't know, for some reason, I got lucky yet again. I don't know if I deserve it or not. I can't really answer those questions. But I do feel that the time I have now is, you know, is extra time.
It's difficult for me to say, and I'll admit that straight away. I can imagine you almost look at the world completely differently when something like that's happened in an extraordinary sort of sense, where you feel that you sort of every single second is time that's valuable to you, like you just mentioned, eh?
Yeah, I think it helps. I'm an excitable creature that loves life anyway, and is very passionate about a lot of things, and you know, tries as hard as you can. I admit I have zero talent, but one thing I can guarantee, I'll try as hard as I can. So that I think having that outlook on life is always helpful anyway. But then when you add it to those kind of experiences, I think, yeah, it's, I mean, I don't look at it as anything different, but you know, when we talk about this and reflect back, I think, you know, I'm lucky. I spend more time, you know, got to spend more time with kids that I might not have had that time, you know, and I might have not done the other things that I've done. I might not deliver level 4 wicketkeeping much. I might have not done all these things that I really, really enjoy doing.
Was it then sort of not focusing on professional cricket for a few years where you could just take a little bit of time out of the game to, well, in a certain way, because you're coaching? But was it did you kind of, not call it quits, that's a terrible way of saying it. Did you kind of then come to terms with the fact that that possibly your coaching career was going to take over then?
Yeah, I think this is the thing that lots of professional cricketers definitely struggle with, the transition of when they finish, where do they go? You know, the PCA is amazing, that's the Professional Cricket Association, and they have lots of things to support players and people like that and getting working opportunities, and they give them lots of information now on directions to go. And as I was coming towards the back end of mine, the PCA were getting much better at that. They're brilliant now, but they were still learning and evolving themselves. So I think the fact that I'd got my coaching in my head in the direction that I was keen for probably really helped. I know there's lots of people come out that don't know where they might go, and probably financially things have changed now for the better, which is helpful for players, but still, that when it's done, it's done, and where do you go? And you know, there's lots of young players that play for 3 or 4 years and then have to consider where they go, and they're not sure, and a lot, lots of people struggle with that. Lots of people come out the game and struggle, but yeah, I was probably lucky that I had a direction that I was kind of interested and excited about. I was involved at Pro Coach Yorkshire Cricket for a year and ran their Yorkshire base there, which is great. Really enjoyed that. And then kind of evolved from there. But I moved out of there after a year because I love the management, the leadership side of it, but I like being on the shop floor. I really enjoy being down and being dirty and doing the coaching, and that's the thing that excites me the most. But I love leadership. I love management. I really do. But if you gave me a choice to do one or the other, then being on the shop floor is the place for me to be.
That's why I wanted to ask you, because if you look at your CV, and we'll get onto it again in a second, sort of close to individual ones, based on, so right, a year here and then potentially doing work elsewhere now where you're almost sort of working as Simon Guy rather than as part of an organisation, is it always about learning all the time, even if it's like sort of one bit from each individual job? Because you've had a hell of a lot of experience playing and coaching, but you're always learning, I suppose, to a certain extent.
Oh, mate, why would you not? That's my question back at you. Why the hell would you not? Every time I walk coach or to do anything, I'm genuinely excited about what don't I know? Because trust me, there's a lot I do not know. Like, for instance, when I was delivering the staff session the other day, you know, Andy Carr was a great friend of mine who was there, and they had another wicketkeeping coach. And I think, great, I gave all my bits, and I was keen to know what they wanted to add. I wanted them to add it because, you know what, they might have come up with one gem that I might have either forgot about or not known about, or it might be their experiences, not my experiences. And, you know, you've got to be humble in that at times and allow people to do that. But also just finding that little gem, or that 1%, every time you're out there, it's, you know, it's brilliant. And that's going to be our exciting move to Notts as well, being around their brilliant coaches, because there'll be things that they'll share and think, wow, what a great thing. And, you know, the male game versus the female game, there's lots of different elements that move in different ways in both platforms. So you're constantly learning, mate. If we stop learning, we're stuffed, because the players are changing, the game is changing. If us as coaches aren't learning to keep up with the players and ahead of the game, you know, you're going to become a useless coach, because things are changing, and you've got to be brave, right? You've got to be open-minded, but you've got to go with it. You've got to. I can't, looking at the good coaches that I know, I can't think of any one of them that wouldn't want to be looking for that next little bit or idea or an opportunity to steal information and knowledge, right? Why would you not?
It comes back to, again, sort of experience over knowledge to a certain extent. You know, everyone should obviously have a basic framework to evolve with that. But, and I mentioned it in a lecture the other day where I was kind of blunt with my lecture. And I said, well, you can have all the knowledge in the world and you can be the best academic that you want, but if you can't practically apply that, you're a bit useless in a certain way, aren't you?
Yeah, well, I thought that the hand in hand, aren't they? You need both, and that's the part of coaching. The skill is sometimes you need to use your knowledge, sometimes your experience, and it's like sometimes you need to step in, sometimes you need to step back. It's it's just having a blend of everything. And you know, it's I don't reflect enough, but when I do reflect, I look back at me as a younger coach versus me as an older coach, and the two different human beings. It's like going back to that spotlight thing today, talking about, you know, how good I am now at being able to just be flexible and immediately change and develop and move. And I think that's because I've got the experience to be able to do that. If I tried to do that when I was younger, I didn't have that knowledge, I didn't have that trust in myself. You know, it was written down and I had a structure to work to, and that's where we're going to go. Whereas right now, you can take it away from me, drop me in it and put me in a different world, and I can just go because I've got that knowledge and experience and understanding. It's, you can't put a price on that, but, you know, you've just got to have bits of everything, and it does, it takes a bit of time, but your toolbox needs to be massive. You need to constantly keep filling your toolbox up.
From that sense, then, getting all these tools, moving on to teaching someone how to use them is a completely different format. And when you started doing the level 3 stuff, and then even sort of the Wicketkeeper module and beyond, was it a case of trying to relay that information over to the next person, or then still learning from coaches who hadn't quite achieved sort of that level 3 just yet?
Well, like, mate, I'm still looking for that one person that comes in one day and throws an absolute gem at me, because it could be anyone. It could be a bloke walking down the street right now. You just got to be open-minded. It doesn't have to be, you know, like I said, Peter Moores or something like that. It could just be anyone that says, oh, I do it this way. Oh, why do you do that? That's interesting. I never thought about it like that. There's always different angles. And it's when I'm doing the level 3 with the keys, that's about a 3-hour, 4-hour module. So that's more about, this is what we're looking for. Here's the fundamentals. Here's what we want. That's kind of what we see, you know. And the good thing about keeping is it's free-flowing. You know, they're all technically underpinned, but I could show you examples of 20 different keepers doing it 20 different ways, but they're underpinned by high quality basics. They just have a different style, a different flow, a different movement, different, you know, way of approaching it. But it's underpinned by the basics. When we get to delivering the level 4, that is a little bit deeper and darker. And it's a bit more about where, why, what are examples of that? What does world-class look like? So I think whenever you're working with anybody, you've got to think about who you're working with, how you approach them, how they approach you. At the end of the day, what can you do to help benefit them? You know, that'll benefit you. And it's a process of just getting to know and getting to work with people. I'm actually doing a bit of work for a friend at the moment, which I absolutely love. So he was involved in the rally scene, and they do the electrical harnesses for inside, like rally cars and on all sorts, you know, E-type Jags, you know, cars that race in Le Mans. And I go over there every now and again just to do a day's work with him, because it is completely different. It's completely out of my comfort zone, and I flipping love it because it's different and it's challenging.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm not the expert. You know, when we talk about cricket, he shuts up and listens to me. But when we're doing the stuff that he does, it honestly blows my brain up, and I absolutely love it. Just for some.
That's why I do this podcast there. Sorry to interrupt you there, but because I almost find myself trying to learn and get ideas and experiences off every single person that I meet. Even if, for example, like yourself, I've been an absolute creep and done my research, of course, delve deep. But then you kind of, I kind of like to have these like little show notes and then just kind of like disregard them to a certain extent and kind of like let it free flowing, because almost little gems come out, like you mentioned, where you're just like, bloody hell, mate, if I would have written that on the paper at the start, mate, this would do absolutely brilliantly. It comes out in conversation where you kind of speak about something else and then you come back to it and boom, you've got your golden moment for the hour, for the, like you said, you go over there for a couple of days and it allows you to sort of love things again in a certain way. No, without sounding a bit bizarre, but yeah.
People talk about being authentic as people, guys. Just be a good person. Not that difficult, you know. At the end of the day, it's a choice. One of my friends on the level 4 always sticks to me. He talks about, there's only one thing in life you've got, he said, and that's choice. So we choose to do this podcast, all right? You choose to have your cap on. We choose things. That's the one thing we have, you know, we choose. I spent 2 years trying to prove him wrong, and then I had to back down and think, God, he's right. I thought there's so many ideas to prove wrong. You know, you're right. You know, we choose to do these things, and it's, you know, try and make good choices and try and be a good person. And I mean, you remember that first kind of, well, you probably the first trip in Holland where we did the dressing rooms, you know, the dressing
yeah.
rooms were cleaner than I did the first one. Lads got on the bus, didn't realize we'd done it, but I put it out there in the universe saying, oh, great work, Jim, you know, support Jim Cricket. And then they all went, right, from now on, we need to be doing that. And sometimes you've got a lead by example, and you've got to get the bus started. But once you get people on the bus, it's a lot of fun. And that was a good example that day, that we started the bus and everyone jumped on board and from then on, we were the team that ended up walking out with the dressing room cleaner than when we walked in. And it was, we were representing ourselves, and me and yourself and your family and our country. And it was great. And, you know, sometimes don't get too deep into it. Just make a choice to do a good thing, mate. It's not that bad.
And mate, you've brought that up, and again, we speak about it. The change room stuff, I tend to find myself cleaning a lot. I think it's just because I'm becoming a clean freak since I've got my own little place now. But you meant one thing which I will clearly remember, and I remember for the rest of my life, is I think after my very first cap, or it wasn't cap actually back then, wasn't it? We hadn't got international status back then. You sat us all down, and it's like, first and foremost, none of you have gone over and thanked the scorers. And I was like, oh shit, like, oh, he's right. So now after every single game, I always thank all the umpires on the field, but then all of them that I sat down, just because of that one moment.
It's 8-4 there, mate. That's all it is.
Mate, and it's quite, I didn't think of that. I didn't actually think of that until you mentioned that trip there, because I was like, oh, bloody hell, I remembered again why. I always remember, obviously, why I do it, but then I'm like, oh, I've never actually told you. So
it's like all those league cricketers that rock up and have a really good Saturday or Sunday, you know, always, where's the groundsman? You know, or groundswoman, groundsman, groundsperson. Thank you. Really appreciate that. Thanks for that. Even if it's the worst pitch in the world, doesn't matter. That they put some time and energy into allowing you to have a day and play cricket. So thanks. Can I get your drink? Really appreciate that. Thanks for that. And even when it is a real good one, let them know. Because, you know, yeah, everyone likes to be liked, you know.
Yeah.
In a flipping belting pitch, let them know. So I really appreciate it. I can see you put a lot of effort in here. Because it's a flipping hard job, that. Blimmin' is.
Yeah.
Just, you know, just little things like that. It costs you nothing, mate. And I think...
It does.
You know, that was the great thing about Jib. There were lots of good people. I loved Jib. It's brilliant. Great people, great environment. New to cricket, new to environments. But one thing I would say, that we were well known as a good group of people. We tried to play cricket hard, but we were learning. But one thing we're always renowned at and people talked about is the fact of what a great bunch of human beings they are. And I think that walking away from any day is a good thing to be said about you.
Yeah, often I actually try and find that, like you mentioned there before, being a good person, you know, don't take a lot. And I've mentioned this a few times on a couple of episodes where I did my last internship at Cardiff City, and I was just having my lunch one day, and we sat with the under-18s, and all of a sudden, you know, obviously academy football, you don't tend to recognise a hell of a lot of people, but mate, all of a sudden, like, Craig Bellamy walks in, and I'm an absolutely huge Liverpool fan, so obviously I know Craig Bellamy from playing for Liverpool, and mate, I'm just like, obviously I'm serious now, I'm a practitioner in professional sport, so I'm like, oh yeah, it's Craig Bellamy, just walked into canteen, all right, cool, yeah, and he'd had an absolute go at these guys, because they'd been like sort of misbehaving or something. He goes, lads, you know, I've heard all these things going on. You got to be good people, you know, do your jobs. You know, you can be the best footballer in the world, and, you know, you just need to be a good person. And that's what, and then he leaves the room and then just storms out. Like, all right, then. Like, mate, like Craig said it, so I got to do it. Like,
I think there's a lot, but special clubs are good at that now, aren't they? Where they get senior players to sit down with academy players,
yeah,
and things like that. And it's that, you know, you're building the next generation. I really buy into things like that. Like where we joined Knox in November, and as soon as we turn up, the whole club is coming to meet us to introduce themselves to us, thinking, what an amazing thing. And we've arranged, as part of who we are, about our identity, having a day with the people that know a lot about Knox, and we want them to educate us in, you know, the tradition of the area, and what's this place and why is that, and what should we need to know to be respectful to them, and also make that part of our transition and part of our relationship now with them. So I think things like that are important.
I think it's invaluable, I think. So, like, it comes down to, again, why I do this every single week. You know, don't get tens of millions of views, but I try and find that I just love it. So, like, just carry on going, you know, regardless of it. So, mate, we're going to move on to the question and answer section. It's something I've done with the last three episodes that I filmed. Well, sorry, three, but two have been released. So, obviously, I said, make a nice little poster, and then everyone answer your question. So, I've got two good ones, which I picked out here. And obviously, I'm not going to mention the name, because obviously I don't know if they wanted to remain anonymous or not. But it says, you, when you took up your mentoring role or your teaching within the Level 3 program, was it, again, similar to what you've spoken about, was it passing on your knowledge or something that might have helped your own coaching?
I got lucky. I think I started that. I think the first one, I've been doing that. Let's see. I've been doing the level four about 14 years probably now. I think I've done level three about 14 years, and level four I've done about 3 or 4 years now. it was Bruce French who used to do it before me, and I think he wasn't available because he was with England. And then he recommended me, and it was an amazing opportunity. I thought, oh, wow, this is great. You know, I went away, spent a lot of time researching because I knew what I knew, and I knew, you know, about things that I wanted to know. But I thought, right, how do I present it? How do I share it? You know, it's all right coaching someone, but when you're coaching someone to coach someone, it's a whole different mindset. And I felt like I started well, but I've always evolved it year on year on year. You know, what else is changing the game? What's new? What else do we need to know? What else can we show them? What other evidence can we have to support our points? So that was kind of how that happened. And like I say, my style is very unique now. It's full of energy and enthusiasm, as most of the things that I do are. They don't get any breaks. But it was something that evolved over time. And it was never something that I looked at. It just came an opportunity, and I got really excited. Same with the level four. I spent so much time building the platform for that. And the delivery. I mean, I'm delivering for two and a bit days. That is a lot of delivery about keeping catching balls. You know, but it's getting into depth and really digging deep and asking challenging questions of them and of myself as well. You know, and I must admit, I absolutely love it. It's exhausting. It really is. But I come off and I am absolutely high as a kite. And screams, that's what you are as a raving extrovert. You know, being around people and doing things and being involved and excited just absolutely supercharges you. I can't imagine an introvert deliver it the way I would, and they'd struggle.
Perfect, mate. Obviously, that it kind of links into the next question, actually, believe it or not. It says, what drives you to keep working with new clubs / organisations across a wide variety of levels? And this is an interesting one, because I had a point about that, actually, when I saw it on Instagram, where, you know, what made you sort of pick the Gibraltar job? Because obviously, we'll admit it, yes, international status, whatever you want to call it, far on a completely nowhere near level to what they might say, oh, they play on the same level as England, not even close. So what made you take up that job? Because obviously, we're a completely different level.
The main reason was Mark Baccarese was on the phone to me regularly, which helped, but I was genuinely excited because of the challenge. And I mean that in a very nice and supportive way. The fact that,
of course, you know,
the amount of people you have is about 10. You know, the space you have is about 0. But yet there was lots of very passionate people, people passionate on the board, but people passionate to play. And I thought, wow, this is going to be really, really difficult, like really difficult. But God, I'd love to try it. I'd love to be part of it. And I got over there and I met the people and I got to know what they were about and what they wanted and how they felt. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to give this a go. I'm really excited. And I knew that there were going to be challenges. I knew it was going to be difficult. I knew it wasn't going to be built around success as in trophies, but it was going to hopefully be built around success in managing good people to be better players, be better people, understand the cultures and the environments, and kind of trying to set something up that helps them move in the right direction long term, you know, rather than just being I'm here for a month or go now. I genuinely hope and pray that the stuff that we did in that period, you know, was like future planning, you know, set Gibraltar in the direction that it has gone now, in the fact of it's got its own indoor practices, it's got its own outdoor pitch, you know, the things that it didn't have, I wouldn't say that by any means about me, but the influences that we had and the passion that we showed people for how we operated made people think, you know what, these are people that are worth investing in. I think that was my main reason, and I like a challenge.
110%, you definitely affected it, and you shouldn't underplay that, because I think far too many people look at, again, results, and they see us, you know, and I think I can vouch for this. This is definitely one thing I can vouch for, where you see on Crick Info or whatever it may be, and you see all these lost columns, but then you don't actually notice about some key points where we sort of feel that we've developed. You know, like in the last tour, we had Denmark, which were ranked something like 40 places higher than us. We had them 10-3. And you notice these key little areas, and I link back all the time to what things that you've mentioned. You know, when obviously when you came over, I was a little bit of a younger cricketer, you know, I'll just call myself old, but you know, you kind of learn from everything, even if it's 5 years ago. So I know it's a completely different changeover and it's a way of doing things, but it all comes from the past, doesn't it?
Yeah, but there's differentiators. It's like when you play against Sweden, there's not one person with blonde hair and blue eyes there. So there are variables in it that
you
might not be aware of as well. So
yeah.
That plays and things like that. And lots of clubs do that. Teams do that, which is perfectly fine. They're well within the rights to do it. But, you know, they're things that people aren't aware of in that environment. But I think You know, the other thing is we went to a tournament with me as a level 4 coach, Andy Carr as a level 3 coach, Stuart Guy's level 3 coach. We rocked up to a tournament with a level 4 coach and two level 3 coaches. I promise you, not one team that we came up against were as organised, prepared, structured as we were. So even if we weren't winning as many games as we'd like to, we were doing the right things. We were operating in the way. We were creating constant learning opportunities as people and as players. You know, we enjoyed each other's off the pitch and on the pitch together. You know, it was brilliant. But, you know, who would have thought before I turned up that Jib Cricket would have had a level 4 coach and two level 3 coaches at a tournament representing the country? It's outrageous.
It was unbelievable, mate. I've learnt a hell of a lot off you, so I definitely can vouch for that. So on to the closing notes, because I've kept you for a long time because I've gone off on a complete tangent.
That's okay.
It's fantastic because Si's actually mentioned some of the points and I haven't, so you know, I've had to say anything, which is always the best way it happens. So look, even here I'm speaking way too much. On to the closing notes. So has there been one or a number of individuals who have influenced you as a player and then as a coach? Sort of when you left the pro game. So I suppose we can split this into two in a certain way. And you've mentioned a decent amount of names there and some unbelievable players, you know, players and even coaches like Peter Moores and, you know, Moorsy. I've read a lot of his stuff. So has there been sort of one or a number?
God, there's been loads. I was very lucky because I spent a lot of time around. I was around so many brilliant people. So Craig White was one of my best mates who coached down at Hampshire and then has moved on from there. Does a bit with the Thunder Ladies as well. You know, played Test cricket, played for Yorkshire. He's a fucking phenomenal player. So, you know, just chatting to him about cricket and non-cricket was always helpful. Being around so many other people. Gordon Lord in the level 4, who went to England Rugby as well, was just phenomenal. Just being around so many people. I mean, it's hard because you're influenced by everyone you come across. And I'm lucky that I've come across loads of people. You know, in my time of playing, I played against Mushtaq Ahmed, Saqaleh Mushtaq, Anil Kumble, Shane Warne, Stuart McGill, you know, people like that. You think, wow, that's
they're all right. They're decent. They can.
It's just being
through and hit a ball.
Being around that and just watching them bowl and going, wow, this is amazing. About that, and get your pole knocked over by them as well. But part of that, and I was involved in that. And it was so lucky. So there's so many people that I couldn't say there's one person said I'm doing that because of that. Just every person I came across has had a real impact and influence on me. And I think if you reverse it probably backwards, I'm trying to think kind of where I've travelled and where I've been. Just everything I've been around and been involved in, people have had a real impact on my coaching, on my life. Probably one that really had an impact when I did my level 4 was a guy called Bob Flack, who was an absolute wizard. This man is a flipping, should be running the country right now, he's that good. But the passionate drive, ex-businessman, used to work for British Telecom when they were a massive company. Unbelievably intelligent man. I use him as my mentor. Like, he's mentored Chris Silver and people like that. That's how good he is. But we're friends because he dragged me down to Suffolk to play and coach for them. But I use him as a mentor. So, you know, we just chat every month or so and just touch base. And it's just finish the conversation and you just go, wow, I feel amazing. Just feel, honestly, you can't, anytime you're struggling, just ring Bob up. He'll just make you feel amazing. Very intelligent. He's a level 4 coach as well. He's at the same time as me. He's just, he's probably one of my biggest impacts out of that level 4. But then just everything, just being around. I think that's why I enjoy being in so many different programs. You're constantly around different coaches. You're constantly talking cricket. You're constantly seeing different views, different opinions that might challenge you in a nice way, that healthy conflict. I think that's probably one of the luckiest things. It's hard to put the nail on anyone there, but there's just so many people that I've come across and, like you say, touched in a different way. And it's just stealing bits from people. You know, that's what it is. You know, you're looking to be around them and steal bits of their energy or bits of their knowledge or, you know, their, whatever it is. But we're constantly stealing for our own benefit.
Mate, if Si's had to have a look at his list there, mate, it goes to show, ladies and gents, sort of what a quality episode this has been. So on to the last point, mate, because this is one thing, because we've mentioned a hell of a lot of advice along this sort of course of this episode, but what is one piece of advice you would have for anyone who wants to be the next Simon Guy, the next professional cricketer, or the next cricket coach influencing an extraordinary amount of people? Because it's fair to say you've definitely done that across your unbelievable amount of experience.
I think my first would be, don't be the next Simon Guy, for God's sake. I think they have some fun, for God's sake. Try and make it as much fun as you can, and that's hard because life is not always fun. I know that. But try and try and enjoy what you're doing, because it's gone sometimes. And, you know, I don't mean that in a really depressing way. I just mean the fact that, you know, you might be playing cricket one day, but you might not be in a few years' time. Just make the most of it. The thing that I kind of try my hardest to live by is find a way. I'm always trying to find a way. I'm not good at many things. I have zero skill. But one, you know, the things that I do is I try as hard as I can, and I'm trying to find a way. Always trying to find a way. So I'd say find your way, and jump onto people around you and close. Don't be afraid to ask for ideas and advice. You know, it might not be good advice, but that's yours to filter, and you can choose to manage that. But you know, steal lots of information. Like if there's any cricketers on here that need an idea or a plan or support or just want to chat for 10 minutes, just drop me a call. I'll chat to you. You know, and it's not even a joke. It's like, you know, if I can help or support anyone, I will. So feel free. If anyone who's listening to this thinks about the wicket keeper, think, oh, I could just do with a few little tips, drop me an email, drop me a message. I promise you I'll get back to you. I might not be liking you, but I'll get back to you.
I'll leave all of your sort of all of your links in the description as well, mate. Obviously, to all your sort of stuff with your coaching as well. So, ladies and gents, what an unbelievable way to finish that! I've lost for words. Unbelievable, unbelievable way to finish this episode. It's been a very special one for myself, having worked with Si, and then obviously hearing his words of wisdom, one to one. Obviously, I was a little brat. Well, I was a little brat, and I was probably about 6 foot tall, shorter. But no, mate, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
No worries at all. And like I said, guys, check him out in the description, and hopefully, fingers crossed, in a few years' time, when I have my nice studio and I have my nice little set, we'll have another chat. So thanks very much, guys, for listening, and thanks again, Si. Take care, guys.